We are going to talk about the history and development of pilot's watches. Pilot's watch is basically another tool for a pilot to use. The most specific characteristics are extreme legibility and oversized cases, truthfully. The first pilot's watch, there's an interesting story behind it. In 1904, Albert Santos Dumont, who was an early French aviator known for hot air balloons and various other weird lighter-than-air aircraft, mentioned to a colleague that it was extremely inconvenient for him to reach into his pocket and check his pocket watch during flight. The colleague actually happened to be Louis Cartier. Louis Cartier took this as a call to arms of necessary ingenuity. So Louis Cartier designed, developed, and gifted one of the first gents wrist-mounted watches to Albert Santos Dumont. It made it easy to quickly check the time at a glance, and it paved the way for pilots moving forward to have a reliable instrument at an arm's reach. From there, the pilot's watch was seen as a tool of necessity for pilots. In 1909, Louis Blériot became the first person to fly across the English Channel. This was no small feat, as it was a significant distance being flown. And at the time, he was wearing a Zenith, with which he was extremely satisfied, and he highly recommended it to anybody with a need for precision. And now this watch, it had classic aspects of what we think of as a pilot's watch now. It had long exaggerated hands. It had big Arabic markers on the dial itself. And the most important thing, it had a huge crown. And the reason behind these big crowns on pilots' watches was actually so pilots could operate them and adjust them and wind them with a gloved hand. The Cartier was the first watch for a pilot. The Zenith is the first pilot's watch. That plays into when we see modern day Zenith pilots. Zenith is actually the only brand that claims to be allowed to use the word pilot on the dial. And this is exactly why. The involvement and development of these watches got other brands interested. Longines was one of them and had a huge part in aviation in general. By the time 1929 came around, Longines actually pushed the envelope further. They made a watch with a complication that was designed to be synced to radio signals. So precision in the field became much higher, and it became more of a standard and more important throughout wartime. As the need increased, as the demand increased for more precise pilot's watches, more and more brands did get interested. Breitling might be the most notable with the injection of the slide rule into the bezel. This was a huge thing. Pilots would always have a slide rule with them and would always have one handy, but this is the first time it was on a wristwatch. The slide rule addition to the bezel of the watch allowed measurements of speed to be determined, distance traveled, remaining fuel, all to be done on the fly. These are calculations that normally a slide rule would be involved, and normally a slide rule was not on a watch. This was a big change and a new standard for Breitling. In a similar time, a couple of years later in 1944, IWC actually started supplying pilots with watches, and these were different than any other pilot's watches that we've seen. These are kind of a little bit more akin to the quote-unquote big pilot's watches that we see today. And again, you have high legibility and huge cases. Now, here's where they really got big, and there was reasoning behind that. So IWC had pieces up to 55, 60 millimeters. Their sole purpose was to be worn on the thigh of a pilot over a flight suit. So naturally, the watch had to be significantly larger than normal. They delivered the watches on extra long straps. They delivered the watches with extra large crowns, again, so pilots could use them with gloved hands and wind them. Not only were the watches used as a tool, but they were used for convenience as well. And of course, first and foremost, it was accuracy, and it was an instrument of the pilot. It also became something more than that. It became something that people who even weren't pilots wanted. This kind of started the effect of the everyday person having the idea to wear a watch like this daily. Maybe not the 55 millimeter ones that were meant to be worn on your leg, but in general, the connection between the casual consumer and the professional became stronger. As time goes on, as you get into the 50s, flights start to get a little longer. And this complicates things in an interesting way. Not only are you in the air for longer, you're actually crossing time zones. So Rolex, in conjunction with Pan Am, created the GMT Master. This allowed the pilot to see time in two time zones at once. Rolex was a company that made watches for the end consumer. They made watches for the public. This is the picture of bridging the gap between the professional and the end consumer. This is where mainstream tool watches really started to take off. Not only were pilots and professionals actually using these tool watches for what they were intended, but the public was also buying them. The public was using them. This kind of comes into where the Speedmaster comes in all of this, truthfully. Late 50s, 1957 in particular, Omega's professional line's released. The Speedmaster is one of the professional watches. This was meant for racing. Omega then, in the next decade, won a bid with NASA to have their Speedmaster Professional be the first watch in space. This is kind of a next step in the evolution of pilots' watches. You have a watch that wasn't meant to be what it is, yet it's good enough to be that. Breitling comes back into the scene and comes out with digital pieces in the next 20 years. IWC, still to this day, is making the big pilots and pilots' watches. Longines is known for their history in aviation. Breitling, their slogan, instruments for professionals. It's all tied into the original reasons why these watches were made. The future of pilots' watches, in my opinion, is aesthetic. The reason being, they are outdated. IWC nowadays has a pilot's watch that's 36 millimeters, that's 39 millimeters, and they go all the way up to 44, 46, 48, and 55. Every aspect of the history represented in that, and that's very cool. And that's wherein the aesthetic of pilot watches will always live on. Pilot's watches have a really cool and long involved history, of which I love learning about. If I missed anything on this episode, feel free to reach out and talk to me about it. I'd love to learn more. I'm Armand. This has been my episode of The Classroom. If you guys enjoyed, please like, comment, subscribe. Thanks for watching.